You're listening to More Than a Song, episode 350. And welcome to this episode of More Than a Song. My name is Michelle Nizat, and this is the podcast dedicated to helping you discover the truth of Scripture hidden in today's popular Christian music. My goal is to teach you to connect portions of God's Word with the songs you're singing along with on the radio, to help you meditate on truths that will transform your way of thinking and ultimately your life. Do you know what I take for granted? The amazing, rich stories found throughout God's Word. I take for granted that I've read them before or heard them in Sunday school or in a sermon. And I also take for granted the number of times I've read them or studied or heard them in a sermon. And I was visiting the other day with my daughter, and we were talking about the phrase holy ground. And I said, you know, that comes from the time when Moses came upon the burning bush and God told him to take off his sandals because it was holy ground. And she responded, yeah, I don't think I knew that. And I know that she's heard the story before because I was with her when we went to see the Sights and Sounds Theater rendition of Moses, which I highly recommend, by the way. And so it's a full stage play, and that scene was played out on the stage. And I'm sure she's heard it at school. She goes to a Christian school or in a Sunday school setting or in a sermon. But the Bible's a big book, and there are many stories. So just because you've read that once doesn't mean you've retained it. And even if you are familiar with the stories, God will meet you in your time in His Word to reveal Himself in fresh ways. And this week's song, Famous For, I believe, by Tauren Wells, refers to quite a few stories in God's Word. I can't wait for you to explore them on your own. That's my hint that we're not going to go over any of them on today's podcast, but I have another exciting place to study this week, and it will incorporate some really great Bible interaction tool exercises that I haven't used in a while, and it'll get us into God's Word reading those stories. But first, let's listen. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire, do what you are famous for, what you are famous for, shut the this podcast, I don't unpack the music. I generally don't tell you the story behind the song. Sometimes I do, of course, but I'm not necessarily even recommending the song. I try to take the music that you are already listening to on the radio and help you use it as inspiration to read God's Word for yourself. And I use Bible interaction tool exercises that I call bites for short to keep my time in God's Word varied. And then I share these bites with you each week. I'm not telling you what you should do necessarily. I'm bringing you along for the ride on what I actually did in my own study time to bring you each week's podcast. I stay in the Word. I stay in the Word because that's where I meet Father God, and I meet my Savior, and I meet the Holy Spirit there. And I stay in the Word for you because I truly believe that if you will join me in investing time in God's Word, He will meet you there too. I believe that. So just from the chorus of this week's song, we see a few areas of Scripture that we could dive into and read for the first time maybe, or reread, and about the wondrous works of God. Now, God makes a way through the waters in the book of Exodus. He does it again in Joshua. He walks in the fire with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel 3. He shuts the mouths of lions in Daniel 6, and he brings bones back to life in Ezekiel 37. So even if you just chose one of those areas of Scripture to read every day, I mean, that could take up a week of reading reading time in God's Word just right there. So if you're ever stuck and you don't know where to start reading, this one song could give you direction for a whole week. And then when you sing the song again, you'll hopefully remember what you read, okay? But the real power is interacting with God's Word. And that's why I teach you my Bible interaction tool exercises. That's why bites are so important, because reading, of course, is a big part of the exercises, many of them, and you need to start there. But digging into the Word takes more than reading. And that's what we're going to get into this week. The opening lyrics of the song declare to the Lord that we can have hope and strength because of God's faithfulness. He's faithful over and over, right? And the chorus declares the wondrous works of God found in the Bible. And this is just a really good practice. This is modeled in Psalm 105. So Psalm 105 begins with a declaration of praise and a call for response before launching into recounting specific works of the Lord. Now, Psalm 105, is a little longer psalm. It's 45 verses. So I'm not going to read all 45 verses to you right now, but these bites that I'm getting ready to share will lose their effectiveness if you just listen to me talk about them and not actually try them on your own. So I really, really pray that you try them on your own this week. Now, the first bite is to read in context. And as I've mentioned before, each psalm stands on its own. You don't have to. Usually when I say read in context, I suggest you read the chapter before, the chapter, and the chapter after. But for the psalms, they're self-contained. So you merely have to read these 45 verses in this psalm. But again, we're not going to break this one up. We're not going to take verses out of context. We want to take in the entire psalm in context. And then the very next bite I took this week was to mark up the text. And I really wanted to feel free to do whatever I wanted and not mess up my Bible, quote unquote, mess it up. You can't mess it up, really. But I did choose to print out the text. I went ahead and copied it into Microsoft Word. I made a really wide left margin. And then I changed the spacing to double space and I just made the font bigger. Then I printed it out. It ended up being 5 pages when I did it like that. I grabbed a pen. You can use colored pencils or highlighters. Whatever inspires you, do that. No rules here, okay? I just used a pen this time because I grabbed it with me and I took it with me. I was going to be waiting in a waiting room and I figured I would have some time to kind of mark up the text. And so I just used one pen. But I've been known to use colored pencils and markers and highlighters and all fun stuff. But now I noticed in my initial reading of the psalm that there were a lot of verbs in the opening lines. So the first thing I did was just to start circling verbs. That was one of the things I observed. Let's go ahead and read the first part of that psalm together just to give us an idea of where we're coming from. You can see what I'm talking about there. Let's start in verse 1. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works, glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength, seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. So if I'm circling verbs, here's what I circle. I circle give and call and make and sing and tell and glory and let and seek and rejoice and seek and seek and remember. And we're going to come back to these action words later, but that is where I started. So depending on the version that you use that you're going to print out, your verbs might be different, but you'll just go to town, start circling. Then I noticed words that were repeated. You may have already noticed a couple words that were repeated as I just read those words. But in fact, this practice or this exercise of noticing verbs and repeated words, both of those falls into the bite of observation. It's a broad bite, but it really does take some intention to notice things. So I observed the verbs. I'm observing the repetition. The more I read it, these things just kind of bubble up to the top. So back to these repeated words, I went ahead and started underlining them with two lines. Now, these repeated words were throughout the psalm. And so I saw words like sing jump out at me. Seek is mentioned several times. Miracles are mentioned a couple of times, as well as judgments. Chosen and covenants were repeated words. And remember is also repeated. Now, it will take the bite of repetition to catch these multiple mentions, and that's a good thing. It is 45 verses, and when it is on 5 pages, I eventually had to kind of spread my papers out just so that I could read it again and make sure I can catch all these multiple mentions. Now, the more you read through the text, the more familiar you'll get with it, and then the more that God can use it to reveal himself to you. So that's that value of repetition, as well as being able to find those repeated words. But I was really drawn to these verbs, and I started using the bite of asking questions and the other bite of making a list. So the first question I asked came out of my observation of these action words. I started to ask, what is this text asking us to do? Because all of these verbs are really pointed at us, not God. These verbs were verbs, that actions that we were to do. But I went ahead and stopped myself. I caught myself starting with me. And it's a much better idea to use the bite of starting with God. So don't worry, we are going to get to how we are to respond. But first, I backed up and let's discover what we learn about God. So I focused in heavily on these first 8 verses, partly because that is the first page of my printed out version. Also partly because it is the call for us to us to remember. And then the rest of the psalm is the remembering. You'll see that as you read through it yourself. So let's go ahead and follow the bite of starting with God and ask, what do we learn about God in these first verses of the psalm? And then I followed the bite of making a list of my answers. Okay, so since I had printed out the text with a wide left margin, I just made notes directly on my paper right next to the text. In fact, I'm going to go ahead and scan my marked up paper so that you can see it for yourself by going to michellenezat.com/350download. So michellenezat.com/350download is, you just give me your email address and I'll shoot you a copy. I warn you, it's not fancy. My handwriting is pretty bad. I forgot to print out the psalm number, the heading, so I scribbled it at the top with a Sharpie. I kind of want you to see it like that. I want you to realize that you can do this too. You know, it's not something that you have to get all geared up for, and it doesn't have to be fancy. And I do also want to say, maybe you don't observe everything I do at first, but I want to encourage you. You're flexing a muscle that will continue to get stronger with use. So here's my list from those first verses that I just read to you when I asked, what do I learn about God? Well, he performs deeds. He performs wondrous works. His name is holy. He offers strength. He offers his presence. He performs miracles. He proclaims judgment, and he remembers his covenant forever. Wow. Drop the mic. Do we need to say anything else? This is the God we serve. We need to respond to that. How should we respond to that? Well, I'm glad you asked, because here's my list from how the psalmist responds, and he leaves this as an example to us on how we should respond. So now we're going to go back to those verbs, and they really tell us how to respond. So I went ahead again, marked it up in my text. You'll see it when you get a copy of it. If you're a current subscriber, by the way, to michellenezat.com, this link is already in your inbox. All right. So, and you can see my scribble, my chicken scratch. But here's how we are to respond. Give thanks. Yes, I need to continue to develop a heart of gratitude. I need to thank him for performing wondrous works, being holy, offering his strength and his presence, performing miracles, proclaiming judgments, and remembering his covenant forever. I need to give thanks. Yes, I need to call upon his name. Oh, how many times do I call upon my husband or my friends first before calling on the name of God? We have a recent episode on prayer. It's come up several times. It was in my pastor's sermon this week. Call upon his name. Pray to him. All right. Make known his deeds. His answers to prayer and his mighty works should be on the tip of my tongue. Both examples from scripture and examples from my daily life. If I don't have any stories of his deeds, I need to add some content sources, because he is at work here in my life, in my church, in my family, in my state, in my nation, and around the world. We need to make known his deeds. Sing praise to him. I don't have to twist your arm to sing. I get it. You're my people, right? You're already drawn to music. Just make sure that you are incorporating singing to God in praise, not just about him or really about yourself, right? Because a lot of songs are really, really self-focused. And while I absolutely love this week's song, it's not until the bridge that we actually sing praise to him, right? We're asking him to do something for us first. Do what you're famous for. And then in the bridge, we are singing praise to him. So just make sure we're always singing praise to him. Tell of his wondrous works. This is similar to making known his deeds. Again, the repetition here should cause us to take note. It's important that we tell other people, okay? The next verb, glory. Glory in his holy name. This word for glory in this context is better translated, make your boast in his holy name. What are you making your boast in today? I tend to want to boast in my own name, or at least I want my name to be something that's worthy of being of boasting about. But the psalmist is reminding us in this simple phrase that, number one, I am not holy, but God is. My boast should not be in my name. I should step forth in humility. I should never want my name to be higher. That's pride. There's nothing to boast about here, but I can glory in the holy name of God. All right, so let your heart rejoice. Let it. Sometimes I don't let my heart rejoice. I hold it captive to rehearsing my sorrows. I need to release the chains on my heart and let it rejoice. Let it respond to the goodness of God with rejoicing. And then seek the Lord. Seek him, not just his hand, him. If all we got was him, it would be enough. I'm not saying we should not call on the Lord with our needs. He asks us to. Scripture tells us to do that. But we need to seek him. Add more of him to your prayer list. Add more of seeking him to your time in prayer. Now, seek his strength. Now, I know we've sought him, we can seek his strength. But really, we pray for him to bolster our strength usually, right? I'm learning to seek his strength. I'm learning to be a vessel of his strength. Don't give me more strength. Let me dissipate. You increase and you be my strength. All right. Seek the word seek here is repeated. Seek his presence. Yes. Now, Psalm 16 says, in God's presence, there is fullness of joy. Seek his presence. And then remember the wondrous works he has done. What are you rehearsing? Are you rehearsing your sorrows? Let's remember and rehearse the wondrous works of the Lord instead. And did anyone else notice how closely linked this one is to make known and telling? If you're going to make known something and tell others about it, you have to remember it first. And I just think it's, again, another place in this first 8 verses that he's repeating that idea. And then it says, remember his miracles and remember his judgments. All of God's deeds and works are wondrous. The miracles and the judgments. If we only remember the miracles and fail to remember the judgments, we will have a distorted view of a fitting relationship with God. When we call on him to do what he is famous for, it includes both miracles and judgments, and both are wondrous. And that's why I made verse 5 our memory verse. It says, remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered. And then here's the secure hope. While we are asked to remember both his miracles and his judgments, what does Psalm 105 say he's remembering? Well, it says he's remembering his covenants, and he remembers his covenant forever. His covenants in the Old Testament are ultimately fulfilled in the New Covenant. And the New Covenant is the promise that God makes with humanity that he will forgive sin and restore fellowship with those whose hearts are turned toward him. Jesus Christ is the mediator of the new covenant, and his death on the cross is the basis of the promise. But we can learn about the character and pattern of God as we rehearse his miracles and judgments as revealed in the Old Testament. And that is what the psalmist launches into for the remainder of the psalm. We really don't have time to unpack it today. We're already almost 20 minutes in. But if you read Genesis, or go ahead and read Genesis, and you read the beginning of Exodus for yourself, you will see how the psalmist recaps God's wondrous deeds. Go read the rest of Psalm 105 and realize that all of the highlights that he's, the highlight reel of Psalm 105 is happening in the book of Genesis and the beginning of Exodus. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't at least read the last verses of the psalm, because the psalmist comes to a conclusion for all of this. He's got like a so what statement of sorts as he finishes up this song of praise and this hymn of remembrance. In verse 43, it says this: he brought his people out with joy, his chosen ones with singing. and he gave them the lands of the nations, and they took possession of the fruit of the people's toil. Now, what he's talking about here is bringing his people out of Egypt and bringing them into the promised land. So that's what he's talking about. And then his why comes out in verse 45, that they might keep his statutes and observe his laws. Praise the Lord. Now, he fulfilled his covenant so that they might keep his statutes and observe his laws. Not so they could walk through water. Not so they could prosper. Did they walk through water? Yes. Did they prosper? Yes. Did they take possession of the promised land? Yes. But our appropriate response to the wondrous deeds of the Lord is to keep his statutes and observe his ways. The New Living Translation says it this way: all this happened so they would follow his decrees and obey his instructions. He brings us out of captivity into freedom and promise so that we can live the way he designed us to live. And just a reminder from Genesis, his design is good. So what's next? Well, try printing out a copy of Psalm 105 to mark up the text without fear. Read the psalm repetitively and then begin to make some observations. Maybe mark up verbs and note words that are repeated. Start by asking yourself what you learn about God in this psalm, and then move into asking yourself how you are to respond. Perhaps use this psalm or even this week's song to inspire you to read about the accounts recorded in God's word and what the songs, whether it's this psalm or this song by Tauren Wells, what these songs are summarizing. Read the root stories for yourself. And while you're in God's word this week, let me know how you're doing. Email me, michelle@michellenezat.com. Hop on Twitter @michellenezat or Instagram @michellenezat. My Facebook page is Michelle L. Nezat. And let's talk about what you're learning. Now, if you haven't joined the 30-day music challenge yet, I highly recommend it. The challenge is to listen exclusively to Christian music for 30 days. It can be harder than you think. You're never too late to jump in. Just submit your name and email address at michellenezat.com/30-day-challenge, and you're in. Now, before I tell you what song will be featured next week, I want to thank any new subscribers who have subscribed recently, like Eric from Germany, Melissa from Oklahoma, Mame from Ghana, Hadley from Colorado, Patrice from Florida, Rosemary from Massachusetts, Ruth from Maryland, and Susie from Texas. Welcome. Now, new subscribers to my website benefit from a one-page resource of my top 5 bites that I've used on the podcast. This is an extremely useful place to start. Subscribers also benefit from an email that I send once a week. And in that email, you get a weekly memory verse resource. I talked about ours this week's today, to display on your smartphone, your tablet, your desktop, or you can print it out. You get an email recap of the week's episode, and you get instant access to any of the extra resources I create for my episodes from time to time. I have one of those this week. So all of that is just my way of saying thank you for listening. So head over to michellenezat.com to subscribe today. Now, have you had a chance to write a review in iTunes for the podcast yet? This really encourages me. It really does. But it also helps me stay visible to new listeners, the way that they have algorithms and how they show my podcast to people. So as always, if you take the time to review my podcast, I will take the time to personally thank you right here on the podcast. Now, of course, you can listen to the podcast directly on my website at michellenezat.com through iTunes or the Apple Podcast app. You can follow on Spotify or Stitcher Radio or your podcast listening app of choice. Well, that's it for this episode of More Than a Song. Next week, I will be using Nothing Else by Cody Carnes to lead us to Scripture. If you liked this episode, however, would you mind sharing it with others? I've made it really easy. With just one click, you can share via Facebook, Twitter, or email. Just head over to michellenezat.com/350. While you're there, I'd love to hear from you. Click on comment to join the conversation. Until next time, take time to meditate on God's word and consider his ways.